Hi, y'all. Meteorologist Andy Hill here at the Weather Forecasting Desk, and Mr. Midas Kitty is back. You've probably heard by now, but if you haven't, another high-end springtime storm is on the way for many of the same areas that saw bad weather last Friday at the end of March. There are very many important updates for the severe weather side of this video, so I encourage you to watch it all the way through so that you're weather aware and that you can relay information to those you may know in the risk area or if you are also in the risk area. This big storm is for Tuesday, April 4th primarily, but also into Wednesday, April 5th, this risk continues to the east and even poses a new hatched risk chance on day 3 from the Storm Prediction Center. This hatched risk here in the yellow indicates where greater severe weather potential exists for more significant events. And as we go through this event, more severe weather will be possible with any residual storms into the southeastern U.S. on Thursday. So, to begin, severe weather will be possible on Tuesday, April 4th, along this corridor of Interstate 35 and areas to the east with time through the day, with a couple of rounds possible in the north and one primary round possible in the south. At the same time, a huge blizzard is going to impact much of the northern high plains here into the Dakotas and into southern and southeastern Manitoba and northern Ontario with time. Another leg of this event is the broad swath of freezing rain possible where it's not snowing heavily but also not thunderstorming quite as much. And that's in these areas of pink hatched here. And also a continual fire risk here in the gray hatch will exist from eastern New Mexico through western Texas into the high plains here. Really, the severe weather system seems to spur the four horsemen of bad weather. We have the critical fire weather in the southwest quadrant here. We have the severe weather in the southeast quadrant here. The freezing rain in the northeast and a huge blizzard going on to the northwest of the low pressure system all at the same time. Now, this map from the Weather Prediction Center is for Wednesday, April 5th, where we have that same blizzard moving into Manitoba and northern Ontario, freezing rain into Quebec and northern New England, severe weather in the eastern Great Lakes region all the way down to the Gulf of Mexico here, including southern and southeastern Ontario, and flash flooding possible into the Gulf areas down here in the Mid-South. An important distinction is becoming clear with this severe weather event on Tuesday, April 4th, and that's to do with the timing of severe storms in each area. So I want to make sure everybody knows when storms are going to happen in each area. Let's dive into each day. The morning of April 4th brings a genesis of a strong surface cyclone ahead of an upper level trough out here in this area of divergence. The important consequences of that surface low developing are another bimodal moderate risk here in the areas of red. First, the northern risk area. Here in the moderate, including eastern Iowa and northwestern Illinois, we see the chance for a couple up to a cluster of supercells popping up mid-afternoon and persisting to the north-northeast through the evening hours. When they develop, they'll follow the warm front, which you can see here on this map of dew points, or how much moisture is in the air at the surface. This area of yellows and oranges pushing up against colder and drier air on the other side of it will serve as the boundary for sustaining and enhancing the tornado threat with existing storms. So follow the warm front to the north through the day for supercell threats. Down here into Arkansas and southern Missouri, there's a lid about a mile above the surface through the entire day that will stop storms from occurring. You can see that here and a sounding taken from the ARRR model. Follow this red line up this graph, which is called a skew T, and you'll see a warm nose feature right about here. This is the temperature of the air as you go up in the atmosphere above your head. And right in this area is when it's actually increasing or staying the same as it goes up instead of cooling. That's what meteorologists look for when we're talking about a cap on the atmosphere or a lid that prevents storms from forming or maturing and persisting. Now, that cap is going to be in place over the southern risk area here in Arkansas and Missouri throughout the day until early in the morning on Wednesday. Boom. Storms develop along the cold front and just out ahead of it here. All of these stronger storms in the yellow, orange, and red here will pose a higher-end tornadic threat in the night to early morning hours. This is exceptionally dangerous because we as meteorologists know that the public perception, and thus the response to tornado warnings in the early morning hours, is halved. This is exceptionally dangerous because we as meteorologists know that in the early morning hours, the perception, and thus the reception of tornado warnings, is halved compared to during the day. And thus, the response to those warnings is also decreased significantly overnight, which is a hazard. The southern moderate risk for tornadoes, this area down here, is not going to have a stabilizing atmosphere overnight, or really much to temper the threat for severe weather as it moves through, except for just a little bit of cloudiness. So that's why there's also a moderate down here, in addition to the supercells expected in the northern risk in eastern Iowa and northwestern Illinois. So please start forming a plan to stay up late if you're in western Arkansas, Little Rock, Fort Smith, into southern Missouri, just to the east of Springfield. You want to be staying up from 11 p.m. through 3 a.m. in these areas, especially from west to east, so later on in Little Rock, a little bit earlier on in Fort Smith, and near Springfield, Missouri. Have a board game night, watch a few more episodes of the show you're working on right now, make a larger dessert than you normally would for your family. Maybe take an afternoon nap, too. Also, see if you can request to come into work later on Wednesday, just to catch up on some sleep if possible. You can cite the tornado threat and that you needed to stay up just in case to make sure you're monitoring the severe weather for your family and friends. Now, it's possible that not much will happen. So this prep work and advice is not meant to give you a lot of anxiety, but rather encourage good practices and raise awareness of risks like this should they materialize on the higher end of things, especially because in this case we have a risk for overnight tornadoes. Earlier today, the Storm Prediction Center put out a specialized update for severe weather on Wednesday, April 5th, throughout the day. We have a cold front sweeping across the nation with a slight risk in the 2 out of 5 in yellow, and this is likely to be upgraded, especially for our northern risk areas here as we get closer to the day of this event. The northern part of this cold front is going to move very quickly off to the east, while the southern half lags and thus includes a slight flash flooding risk down here due to storminess lasting for quite a few hours. This severe weather risk doesn't stop at the border, of course. It's also going to expand into southern and southeastern Ontario, maybe as far east as Ottawa. So all of the Toronto metro here is going to be in the risk area in the Great Lakes region. Storms will be along the cold front, but staying mostly with the cold front from Michigan through Ontario, all the way down to the Gulf of Mexico, as you can see here in the expected rainfall areas in green, reds, and yellows. I think as we go into the day on Wednesday, multiple rounds of severe weather are possible, especially in eastern Michigan, down into Ohio, and also into southern Ontario. So, timing on Wednesday. We could see supercells develop in the early afternoon to evening hours up here in Michigan, out ahead of the cold front, and then the cold front comes in moving west to east here. So let's track this. This is what it looks like early Wednesday morning into Wednesday afternoon, Wednesday evening towards Thursday at midnight. In the southern half of the risk area down here, it looks like storms will mostly stick with the front, posing several hours of unsettled weather as it tracks to the east. The threats down here will be damaging winds and brief, hopefully weak, spin-up tornadoes. At the same time, the northern half of the storm will persist through Wednesday, bringing those blizzard conditions and heavy snow toward the Canadian border and also across into southern Manitoba, eastern Manitoba, and into northern Ontario. Also, freezing rain and/or sleet will be possible all the way headed up towards northern Ontario, across Quebec, through Montreal, and northern New England here, moving from west to east with time on Wednesday. So, after this, what's next? Looking at our ensemble runs here, we can see that after this big-time severe weather event moves through, we start to get into a pattern here where there will be a big ridge over on the west coast and a big trough on the east coast. So that trough's over here in blue behind my webcam, and our big-time ridge is over the western half of the U.S. in red. This is a look at that from the Global Forecast System ensemble as well. Since we just looked at the European model, we can see that big storm move through, and then our ridge starts to set up kind of in the west and a trough in the lower right part of the screen behind my webcam here. What that means is, at the end of this week into the beginning of next week, it's finally spring in the western half of the U.S. There it is. This might also include parts of Alberta and Saskatchewan as well for springtime warmth. It also greatly reduces the threat for big-time spring storms like we've seen these last couple of weeks going through. Just look at this map from the Climate Prediction Center of our expected weather risks from a week out from now to 2 weeks, so the period from April 11th to 17th. Almost nothing! Isn't that great? We do have a flooding risk over here encompassing much of the central valleys of California, the Sierras, and into Nevada. This is because warm springtime temperatures that are going to settle in here over the next week or two are going to start melting the massive snowpack in the Sierras. So we'll have to watch out for a bunch of runoff into rivers that would pose a river flood threat. So here we can see, there's our big ridge setting in place and increasing the temperatures over much of the western U.S., but also the eastern U.S. stays pretty nice and warm as well. You can see how about 2 weeks out from now, this ridge starts to move towards the central U.S., and some of the Pacific coast may cool off and be a bit more mild for a while the very above average temperatures move in to the central plains. Here's a look at the effects of the expected precipitation, also for those same days. So when our big-time ridge sets in here, we're going to have sunny and warm weather here, decreasing the chance for precipitation in the west, the southwest, and the mountain time zone. We may still get some rainy weather up here in the Pacific Northwest. It might stay just a little chilly over there, because it's usually rainy this time of year. And then when we go up to 2 weeks out, we can see downstream Lower precipitation than average is expected across the eastern U.S. So this signals to me that we won't really get those big-time severe weather events moving through in this period through mid-April. Now, this is not to say that we won't see small systems and short waves move through, posing sneaky severe weather risks from day to day as we go through this period of mid-April. It's spring. We could even see northwest flow events as we go through these days. We could see short waves aplenty and more reasons for severe weather. But the hope is that the big-time nationwide spring storms like this one moving through Thursday are done for a little while. Eventually, into late April, this pattern's going to flip. We're going to see this ridge move off into the east here, a trough build into the west, posing some more unsettled weather over there, and then anything that forms over here and moves off to the east is going to do the thing again, where it forms a big old surface cyclone and brings a giant squall line through the U.S. But for now, let's pull through this system until it's out of our hair, staying weather aware, and then we can hopefully enjoy the proceedings after that of a calmer week of weather in the middle of April. I'll be live streaming the nowcasting part of this event coming up on Tuesday and Wednesday alongside Ryan, and that will include Southern Ontario radar coverage on Wednesday as well, should we go live on those days if the severe weather risk is increased from the Storm Prediction Center. So make sure to stay tuned. Thanks for watching this through, and I hope it did help. I appreciate your time. And make sure you're letting people know in these risk areas to stay weather aware at those different times that I pointed out in this video. Again, that northern moderate risk area in Iowa and Illinois is going to be during the day, and then another chance at severe weather into the nighttime hours with that cold front passing through. But south into southern Missouri and through western Arkansas is really going to be in those nighttime hours, posing a dangerous nocturnal tornado threat. So I want to make sure that we leave off on that note. Stick that in your brain, and I'll see you soon.